Hi, this is Carl Leopsen at the University of Arizona. And in this activity, I'm going to walk you through the use of the quality indicators for single subject research format in reviewing the quality of a piece of single subject research. And the purpose is for us to start to learn about those quality indicators that first appeared in the Horner et al. Article in 2005 that we read earlier. And another purpose is for me to sort of walk you through a single subject article, because some of the information, it's not hidden, but it's in specific spots in most of these articles. So I want to clue you into that. The article we're going to look at is SEAC, Fehrenkrog, Ayers, and Smith from 2009, and it's from the Journal of Positive Behavior Interventions, and it's about video modeling via iPod and a system of least prompts to improve transitional behaviors of students with autism spectrum disorders. So let me start to walk you through the article first. I've highlighted in the piece that I'm going to ask you to read in green the sections that I think are really important for you to read and where you're going to find the meat of the information that's going to translate to the quality indicators form. And in purple, the sections that you may want to read or even shouldn't read. Definitely let you get through some of these articles a little more quickly when we review more of them. First, I would read the abstract. It's going to give you a general overview, obviously, of the entire piece. Abstracts usually aren't written until after you write the entire article. That helps you summarize it more clearly. The introduction, strangely enough, there's nothing in Horner's quality indicators for single subject research that suggests that you have to have a great argument for your research question. So read it or don't read it. However, it's a really good example of an introduction to a research article. It's something you could model yours after. The very last thing in any of these research proposal introductions or research article introductions is going to be the research question itself. So I would read that. This is a very good example of a research question, two research questions actually. The research question that is measured via the single subject research design, and a second research question on social validity that is measured in a more qualitative way. Then comes the methods section. So this is a really important section in terms of the quality indicators. Most of these quality indicators are about the quality of the design of the study and the conduct of the study. All of that is listed in the methods, right? That's the most important section of a single subject research article as pertains to these quality indicators, right? Description of the participants and settings almost always comes first, and in your quality indicators, if you read the Horner article, these come directly out of the Horner article. And this form was put together by Candace Lane, who was one of my doctoral students. And you'll see that there's a real emphasis on replicable precision. All right, enough precision to allow replication. Critical features of the setting. Process for selecting participants is described with replicable precision. So you can take a look through this participant section and decide for yourself whether you think there is enough information here that another researcher could actually conduct this study, could actually find similar participants. All right, and whether or not the setting is described in enough detail that someone could replicate the setting. The materials are listed here also. There's nothing in the quality indicators necessarily about materials, which I think is also a shame, kind of a loss, because in this technology-laden world, we use lots of materials that need to be described really carefully. The next section is the response measurement and data collection in the article. Also important, that's where you're going to find the dependent variable in this particular piece. Sometimes the header in these articles will just be dependent and independent variable or measurement. In this case, it's response, measurement, and data collection. But this is where the dependent variable, or what is being measured, is described. So take a look through, after you read the article, after you read the Horner article, take a look through these quality indicators. Take a quick read through this short section to see whether or not each dependent variable is measured with a procedure that generates a quantifiable index. Right? See whether or not the dependent variables are measured repeatedly over time. This last question, data collected on the reliability or inter-observer agreement, that's going to come later. I'll show you where that is. Independent variable. The independent variable is the intervention. The experimental design is actually listed next in this study, and that is this, which single subject design are they using in the study, and this happens to be an ABAB or a withdrawal design. The experimental procedures section in this article is where you'll find information about the independent variable and whether the independent variable just is described with replicable precision. In other words, could you carry out the experimental procedures in this study after reading this section? The next section on the quality indicators form is baseline. There is a section in the experimental procedures that describes what the baseline is. You should read that in order to get information about the baseline. But you can also jump to another section that we'll get to in a moment. Oops, did we skip it? What did we miss here? No, we didn't skip it yet. We'll get there in just a moment. We'll get to the graph in just a moment and some of the information you can get from it. Also, this last question, an independent variable, overt measurement of the fidelity of implementation for the independent variable is highly desirable. That is treatment integrity. These last two questions of each section on dependent variable and independent variable will both be found in the reliability. So there's reliability in this article. They are talking about reliability of the dependent variable, which is measured through inter-observer agreement, and reliability of the independent variable, which is measured through procedural reliability or treatment integrity. Right. So take a look at both of those in this particular section. So the section on reliability covers this question under the dependent variable and this question under the independent variable. The next section in the article is social validity, which is at the very end of our form of quality indicators. And this is where you will find information about how they measured social validity, but not necessarily the results for social validity. For experimental control, we're going to take a look at the graph. Nice looking graph in this. And when we get to graphing, you'll see what I mean. The zero is up off the baseline. But see all these zero points? If they had this horizontal axis actually running across the zero line, you'd have what looked like another line connecting a bunch of zeros. And that would really be confusing to the observer, so or to the reader. So it's nice that they have the baseline below the zero, or the horizontal axis below the zero. It's nicely labeled. It's really well put together graph. In any case, it's a good place to look to see whether or not there are three demonstrations of experimental effect at three different points in time, whether or not the design controls for threats to internal validity, and whether or not there's a documented pattern that demonstrates experimental control. We haven't learned about all that necessarily. We'll talk about these elements later. And also about the external validity, although you can see that the results are replicated across participants, settings, or materials. In this case, it's replicated across participants and within participants. So when you are reading the section in your textbook about direct replication and systematic replication. Direct replication is the replication of the study within the subject field. So here you have a baseline, you have the video modeling, no video modeling, then they go back to video modeling. That's the replication. We've gone from the baseline to the experimental condition, turned it around back to the baseline, back to the experimental condition. Not only did we replicate there, but replicated across students. That's all direct replication. Systematic replication has more to do with someone replicating this study, which is why replicable precision is so important, to be able to replicate this study to a large degree, to show that we could do multiple studies, and then we can start to generalize those results for this particular independent variable. Let's take a look at the rest of the study. Actually, there's not much left to read. The results, nobody reads the results. The results are just an English language transcription of where these data points lie, their trend, their levels, but you can look at the graph and do that. Nobody reads the results unless they think something's wonky in the graph. Then they read the results. Do read the results on social validity. It'll help you answer some of these social validity questions and give you some good ideas about how you might do it in your own study. Look in here, look at this social validity. Think about the Hawkins article and the Wolf article, and think about whether or not are they only measuring consumer satisfaction, or are they measuring something more important? What is important in their study in terms of social validity? And is the magnitude of change in the dependent variable socially important? Did they get enough of a change that it makes any difference? And finally, in the discussion section, you can read the whole discussion section if you want to. The first paragraph of the discussion section usually is a nice summation and is almost a repeat. It's almost where you start to pull together your abstract for your article. It's almost the exact same thing as the abstract. That's the whole piece. If you have questions as you're conducting this process, let me know. When you're finished taking a look at this, this is practice. This is the first one. You don't have to go crazy making comments. Really what I'm looking for in the discussion section are just a couple of comments about what did you think was well done, what was surprising, what do you think was missing. Also understand that if something is missing here, it doesn't mean these people are bad researchers. It could be that they just didn't include it in the article. Maybe they really did these things, some of the things that are missing. They just weren't reported. Maybe the editor said, there's not enough room in the journal this time. You need to leave some pieces out. Maybe it was an oversight that they left out information. Or maybe there are things that really are inherent in the study that are missing. All right. So what I want in the discussion section is just what looked like it was good, what looked like it wasn't possibly done well in terms of quality indicators, some concerns, issues, or questions you might have. All right. I'll see you in the discussion section.